paycheck, you're limited to two sick days, so you gotta do one of two things. You gotta round up to 310, that would give you some two sick days. Grams are gonna cancel, even if it's milliliters. That's one way of doing it. You could have rounded down to 300, but you have to put that in two sick days. That's another way you could have done that too. Then the third one. You got, you want mass. You got a density of 0.800 grams per milliliter and a volume of 3.000 liters. Know that mass is density times volume. M equals D times V. You gotta convert that into milliliters because you can't multiply liters by milliliters. 1, 2, 3, three spots to the right. That came out to be 2,400 grams. Milliliters cancel. You got three sig figs there, four sig figs there. You really write that as 2.40 times 10 to the third. Perhaps it gives you your three sig figs. Any questions there? Well, those were the first three problems on the exam, so I thought that would make a good warm up because sig figs were probably the most missed part. Most of the mistakes were sig fig mistakes on the exam. All right, we can go. Get started. Sort of the exchange between unit one and unit two occurs right here when we talk about electron configuration and what that's all about. This is kind of where we're at. We're transitioning into unit two. Our lab today is titration. It's on a handout we'll get when we go to lab. And then the scores for the test were posted. Usually I got right after Wednesday. And you guys have scores posted before I left. So you've been able to see yours for a while. Anyways, transitioning on, in chapter four, there's a few objectives to find energy, potential versus kinetic, temperature, atomic models, the Thomson-Rutherford, and the modern or quantum model of the atom we'll look at. Electron configuration of the first 10 elements. That really explains what the quantum model is all about. And then electron configuration we use to predict elements bonding, and that's the transition into the next chapter. So first up, what is energy? Energy lets you do work. You ate breakfast this morning. Eating breakfast allows you to get moving, go do other stuff. Get in your car and come to class or go to work. Some examples of energy, there's potential, what's called stored energy, that's food or gasoline. That means is the energy sits there until some process converts it into work. An example of food, you may cook breakfast, you may eat, I don't know, something out of a vending machine, protein bar or whatever. Maybe you decide to eat for breakfast. That food's there in that wrapper until you unwrap it and start eating it. Food's potential energy. The food gets converted to had biology, you talked about the Krebs cycle and glycolysis and all of that stuff. That converts that food into useful energy for your body to do work. Gasoline in the car is not much different. Got gasoline in your car. Gasoline will sit in the gas tank till you put the key in the ignition. The ignition key turns a starter motor, which moves crankshaft up and down, also engages the fuel pump. Fuel pump pumps gasoline from the tank into the fuel injectors, where it's mixed with the right amount of oxygen to be burned inside the engine. Once it's burned, the expanding gases force what's called a piston downward, which turns the crankshaft, which drives the transmission, which propels the vehicle down the road. That's how gasoline works. But it's there when you need it, and it just sits there as potential energy when you don't. Now, kinetic energy, once you've got the gasoline and the car started, you have kinetic energy. The engine's running. Pistons are moving up and down. Car's ready to go somewhere. Energy of motion. Once you eat breakfast, you're fully energized. You have energy of motion. And one thing about energy is you understand energy flow. And energy flow here's a car at the top of a hill, and that car, in terms of position, is what's called a high energy state. That car does not want to remain at the top of that hill. That car wants to go down here. Physicists call that a resting position. And you may take a physics class someday in your academic travels. You get a lot more into this flow of energy, and you actually do a lot of calculations with it. But the energy flow has to go down. Now, if you want to get this car back up the hill, you have to put in energy to get the car back up. And you got to get some buddies out, and they start pushing. Push, 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 push. That car does not magically transform itself back to the top of the hill. Last few nights it's been cold. You might have turned the furnace on at your apartment or house, wherever you live. That furnace runs off of energy. The apartment does not spontaneously heat itself. Again, to get to that energy state, you have to put effort or work into the system to get it back to a high energy state. Same in the summertime, your house does not cool itself. You have an electrical air conditioner, you flip the switch, electricity drives the motor, which pumps the high energy out of the house. High energy molecules, the water molecules, I should say. Well, let's see here. Energy units, calorie or joule. Calorie is the English expression, joule is the SI, Systems International expression for energy. And the unit conversion for that is 4.184 joules equals 1 cal. And the temperature measurement is a measurement of the kinetic energy of that system. So systems with high energy, I should say high kinetic energy, or low kinetic energy, depends on the state of the system. J Generally, if the system's hot, it's warm, it has high kinetic energy. If the system's cooler, it has lower kinetic energy, thus has lower temperature. Boiling water versus frozen water. Boiling water, very high, very agitated. The water molecules are moving all over the place. Frozen water, no, they're packed in nice and tight. They're getting very comfortable with their neighbors because they're frozen in place. If you have a low energy movement in that system, you're gonna have low temperature. Any questions there? Radiant energy. Radiant energy is energy from light or photons. Turn on an incandescent light bulb at home and let it run for about 15 minutes and go over and put your hand on the bulb. You're going to get burned. Why? The energy from that photons is producing light or photons of very high kinetic energy, which results in that system getting to a very high temperature. Energy for that system in terms of light can be expressed in terms of energy. H nu, H is Planck's constant, and nu or V is the frequency of energy. Again, if you go on and take physics, you'll do a lot of calculations, but, or Chem 111, you'll do some calculations for that stuff. The visible light spectrum is very narrow, but that's what the human eye detects. So anything above or below that wavelength, the human eye can't detect. That's also called the color spectrum. Atomic models, Thomson model. Thomson, remember, he focused on the electrons. Rutherford introduced the concept of the protons. Of course, I left Millikan and the neutrons off there. The modern or quantum model is based on energy levels. And if you look on your periodic table, you'll see there's numbers right below here. It's called a period. Each period here, 1 through 7, refers to an energy level, 1 being the lowest, 7 being the highest. And inside those energy levels, you have electrons that occupy what's called an S, P, D, or F orbital. I call it a system. But those S, P, D, and F are simply homes or boxes, if you will, for those electrons, and we'll take a look at that up close and personal here in a minute. But within each energy level, you can have S, P, D, or F, depending on how big the atom is. For our discussions, we're just going through the first 10. So we'll be only visiting S and P. But if you take Chem 111, you'll get a lot more into the D and the F electrons for that class. And if we work through the quantum model, again, the quantum model is going to be based on energy levels. And within those energy levels, you can actually define where the electrons are going to be. So it's a little more detailed model than just saying they're outside the nucleus. Energy levels, again, start with the lowest or first row all the way down to the seventh row. And if you look at the period number on the periodic table, that also corresponds to the energy level of the electrons within that row. And atoms fill with electrons. And this is where we'll start our tour. Let's see how these things fill up. Couldn't find my super strong magnets this morning. Don't know where they're at. Have to send the search and rescue team out after them. First, we start with hydrogen. We are in the first row and the very first element right there. So its first electron goes in the lowest level of the four suborbitals, s, p, d, f. S being the first one that gets filled or the lowest in energy. And we put one electron in there for s. Then we move on to helium over here, and it has two electrons. And the significance of that is that S set right there, that's what gets referred to as a So bearing that in mind, you've completed your tour of the first row. So we have to go down to the second energy level to fill first the next one. So the next one, we have a 2s1. And in that 2s1, we have lithium, which is three electrons. One, two, three. We have three electrons there for lithium. Next, we're on to beryllium, which is a 2s2. So you're going to have the 1s2 and the 2s2 full. You draw those out too. So I'm going to draw this as the 1s2 and the 2s2. That down.
when you get to boron, notice that the 2s2 is full. So we have a 1s2 that's full. Question is, where do we fit number 5? So where we're at in our fill pattern is we filled the 1s1, the 1s2, the 2s1, and we're going, we just filled the 2s2. Now when we get over here to boron, we have to introduce a p orbital, and that becomes a 2p1. And that's how we get our 5. Remember, this is atomic number or number of electrons, respectively. So when we hop to carbon, start stealing from over here. We'll see that the P box doesn't get full until we hit 6. And we'll see how that all plays out here in a second. So you got 2, 4, 6 for carbon. And then next up, we have nitrogen. That we get to 7, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7. That becomes a 2p3. Then I keep going on, and I can go to oxygen next. And we move on. There's where my 9 comes from, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then I get to neon finally. was significant about neon? Well, this 2P6 is now a full house. And that's what I was referring to last time when we talked about the magic number of electrons. 2, 10, 18, 36, 54, 86. What happens there is we're going to see that elements over here on this side will gain electrons. Elements over here will lose electrons to get to these magic numbers. We saw that with ions. Within each family, a family has a specific charge. It's going to tell us how we know and why, say family 1 is plus 1, family 2 is plus 2. We'll see all that here in a minute. But that's simply explained through the loading system of the where the electrons are going to be or where they're going to load. And the P6 shell, again, that's a full house, and that's common to all noble gases. All noble gases will have a full P outer shell here. And if you look, this one doesn't have it. We have a wall chart down there that has the orbital filling numbers out here, which is pretty cool. And that full P cert, full P6 is what makes them inert. Question?
I'm going back to 1s, and I'm like, the sodium is 3s, 4s, depending on that.
Yep.
Why does it, I'm a second layer, why does it go 1s, 2s, and not just 2s?
Hold on, where are you at here?
Like lithium.
Lithium.
Why is it 1s1, or 1s2, 2s1?
Because the lower orbital always has to fill first.
Then why is it like that for the other one?
Which one?
It's sodium. Why is it just 3s?
Okay. Well, no, it would be a 3s1. Because you have to build 11 electrons up there. So you're going to have the P6 from 10. 10 plus 1, the next one has to go into an S.
Okay.
She
actually just explained it. Because you see the neon next to it. Yep. I wasn't thinking like they were adding this one to layer.
No. Mm-mm. No, neon's full. So you have to, once the P6, and you have to start with the next number as an S.
Yeah.
So if you were going to go to 11, the next one up would be a 3S1.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It goes S, P, and then when you get in this row here, you start what's called D electrons. That's transition. We're not going to get into that. We'll be using transition cations when we make salts, but we're not going to get into their electronic configuration. We stop at number 10. And that's chapter 4. That leads us into, I'll have to open. Chapter 5. In chapter 5, objectives classify matter as mixtures, compounds, or elements. That's going to be next week's lab. Next week's lab is going to be cleaning oceans, which will is a mixtures lab. We will see what vocabulary is associated with mixtures up close and personal in that lab. Compounds and elements, and there's elements that exist as diatomic elements. Ion charges and families, that's very important because that essentially is the key to lock that unlocks what's called bond types, ionic and covalent, which is at the right at the heart of unit 2, which will involve separating ionic compounds from covalent compounds and doing naming back and forth on that. So I'm going to get this stuff down here real quick. Eight.
up Matter.
That's so much sharper than it is down at Dome. I'll give you a Matter chart here.
If you look at Matter, Matter is anything. Matter is stuff. That's the term I use. Because you can taste it, breathe it, walk on it, touch it, feel it, hit it with a baseball bat. It's matter. Matter is everything. If it has mass, it has volume, it's matter. Matter can be broken down into two categories, either mixtures or pure substances. Getting from mixtures to pure substances, that's what next week's lab is all about. Because when you've got mixtures, you've got heterogeneous versus homogeneous. Heterogeneous just means you have two layers, or I like to call them two phases. You have here a top phase, which is oil. Here you have a bottom phase, which is water. You see two distinct layers. Here, homogeneous, it's all a single phase. You see no distinctive separation. And they're homogeneous, means same phase. Then if you got pure substances, you can either have a compound, and a compound by definition is simply two or more elements. The compound they have there is they have H2O for their compound. And then for the element, any element, to be an element by definition, you must have a box in the periodic table. And our boxes range from 1 to 118. If it does not have a box in the periodic table, it is not an element. And on your chart, you see that there's matter. Matter's classified. It has three states, solid, liquid, and gas. Again, if you can touch it, feel it, taste it, or breathe it, it's matter. You can have pure substances broken down into elements and compounds. Mixtures can be either homogeneous or heterogeneous. And changes of state, simply going from solid to liquid to gas, back and forth. We used to have an energy lab we did with that a while back. But we changed books that kind of de-emphasized energy, so we kind of dropped it. Handy dandy phase chart, states of matter. Like I said, we'll get all that vocabulary knocked out in next week's lab. There's elements that are diatomic. Look at the upside down L on your periodic table. If you start with, plug this. Learn the dot cam will not work if this thing's plugged in. If you look, and here starting with astatine, you go up and over to nitrogen. All these elements here on this upside down L are diatomic. So when you refer to nitrogen, nitrogen
nitrogen, the element, is N2. Nitrogen, the atom, is N. So the air you're breathing right now is a mixture of O2, N2, not oxygen atoms and nitrogen atoms. Because it's an element that's diatomic. Along with the whole halogen family, this blue column right here. Take a look at group one. The group one element I have, first up, hydrogen. Hydrogen, even though it's on, stuck in, I've got a big periodic table wall size, so I can stick it up on that wall right there. Hydrogen is not a member of group one. Hydrogen is really separate. I like where they put hydrogen here. Hydrogen is a family of one. It is not a family member of group one. Group one actually starts with lithium. So if we look at lithium, this is family one. So family one would have, in this case, this has a 2s1. Which means if it loses this electron, in this case it goes from 3 electrons down to 2 electrons to get to the full 1s2 level. To do that, remember the magic numbers of electrons are 2, 10, 18, 36, 54, and 86. This goes from 3 to 2. So it loses that 2s1 that gets lost. It becomes a plus 1 cation. Okay. Family 1. All family one members go plus one. So anytime you take an element out of family one and you're going to make an ionic compound with it, its charge is going to be plus one. Next up. Group 2 goes 2s2. And I've got to change my card out here. 2 beryllium. And what beryllium does is to get back to a full shell of noble gas configuration. It takes these two and loses those two, which makes a plus 2 cation. So all members in family 2 go plus 2. Any questions there? Then we hop over. Family 3, we have the 2s2. filled. We also have a 2B1. And we change here from brewing to moron. So boron, to get back to a full shell, takes these three electrons, loses the P1 and the S2, and makes a +3 cation. Now in group three, you have the introduction of the term metalloid. Metalloid is a fancy word for semi-metal. What that means is it has properties of both metals and non-metals. And that's the first three families. Then we go to family four. Now family four gets a little interesting. We've got 2s2 and the 2p2. Make this a little bigger. Family four members can twist in the wind. Why can they twist in the wind? Well, they can go forward or backward the equal number of steps. If you take away the two P1s, oops, two P1s, how about we take away the two P2s? There we go. We take away the two P2s and the two S2s, we make a +4 cation. But also, if you remember, you could also bring in four more blue ones to go forward an equal number of steps, and now you have a -4 anion. So to make a long story short, family four members can swing both ways. And you have a non-metal, which is carbon. You have metalloids, silicon and germanium. Silicon and germanium are going to be your main players in going +4, because they have that duality of a metalloid. Metals, generally lead and tin, are going to be positive. They're going to always be cations, because that's what metals do. Charge +4, electron configuration P2. Once you're past family four, then it's all anions from there. So we go to the next family, family five. And your choice for family five, let's get a family five number up in first. We're still staring at a family four number. So with a family five member, there's your five electrons, which what makes it a family five member, by the way. Notice that the numbers on top, these numbers here, will correspond to what's called a valence number. Boron will have, the boron family will have 3, carbon family will have 4, nitrogen family will have 5, oxygen family will have 6, the halogen family will have 7 valence electrons or bonding electrons available to bond with other elements. And we'll see that more closely when we study bonding. But this really explains everything you need to know about bonding. In this case, nitrogen can do one of two things. It can pluck these 5 off and go backwards 5 steps. Or for nitrogen, what's preferred is the least number of steps. I go from a P3, if I bring in 3 more electrons, I have a full P shell, which gives me my P6. So what nitrogen and the nitrogen family members like to do, they go -3. That's a -3 anion. The reason for that is right here. You're going to bring in 3 to fill that P shell up. Any questions there? And let's see, inside the nitrogen family, we've got nonmetals. Nitrogen, phosphorus, arsenic, antimony for metalloids, and metal is bismuth. Family number 6, you have the 1s2, then the 2s2, and then you have the 2p4. And the choice this family has to make is either lose these 6 to get back here, or, should have this up there, you can go forward. Fill the 2p6 up. Well, what do you think is going to happen? The least number of steps is 4 over 2, so we're going to bring in 2 electrons and fill that thing up. And in that case, these guys go -2, and they make -2 anions. And inside the oxygen family, you have the nonmetals, oxygen, sulfur, selenium, the metalloid there is tellurium, metal down at the bottom, polonium, charge -2, electron configuration P4. Then we hop to our next family we'll look at, number 7. Probably the most reactive family on the table, which is called the halogen family. And halogen we'll look at is probably the most reactive halogen. Fluorine 19, in this case, you're going to have P5. Fluorine can do one of two things. Lose 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, lose 7 to go back to the 1s2, or go forward 1 to reach the 2p6. And what the halogen family prefers to do is take an electron from anything it can get
chemical plant I used to work at down in Texas, the guys that handled the fluorinated compounds, they got hazardous duty pay, but after 5 to 10 years of that, they also had very little fingernails left because the HF would get into the gloves, even though they were protected, and over the years, they just eat the fingernails away. Really reactive stuff to get an electron from anything it wants, it can take, and then you have family members. 7 all go minus 1, and they make what's called minus 1 anions. And then the last family, 8, I'm already just going to put that over here. Because when you get to family 8, the house is full. You have the full 2P6, and everything before that's full. The 1S2, and the 2S2 are all full. Six, 7, 8, 9, 10. There's your 10 electrons accounted for. Any questions? So if we look at this from the big point of view, we set all this big picture point of view. So, first up, we start at family 1 on your periodic table. That's called 1A. And that would be lithium. Then 2A. Then we have this block in the middle here.
transition elements, or D-blockers, as I refer to them. And then we emerged from the transition elements into 3A, 4A, 5A, 6A, 7A, and 8A, or what's commonly referred to as 0. And you'll also notice that there's another numbering system along the top, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. That's called the IU path numbering. It's the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemists. Make a long story short, that's what most people use nowadays. This is the old system, the A and B system. Notice that the transition elements are targeted as 3B, then they go, they switch over to and end up at 2B. I don't know how they, that's kind of a weird system. I don't like it myself, but anyways, getting back to this, again, family one, plus one cations, family two, plus two cations, family three, plus three cations, and family four, you can have plus four cations, but you can also have, this is where the transition occurs, to the blue, which is minus four anions, then minus three anions, minus two anions, minus one anions, and zero. Actually, I should use green for that, because green is our neutral color in this. I've been using blues for negatives and reds for positives. That's the periodic table laid out. Be nice if I had a big board, I could do all that up there on the wall, but I can't. So this is my wall version improvised. But this we need to know, the charges of the families, because when we do formulas, there's going to be two things when we do ionic formulas. It's going to be named a formula and formula to name. So when you have a formula, if you can't get the charges out of it, it's hard to name it, and vice versa. If you got a name, you need to associate the name with its position on the periodic table, what family it is, and then get the charge of that cation or anion, and then put the two together. We're going to see all that come into play. But we finished up here with halogens, all nonmetals, charge negative one, and then we end up with these full P6s down here. Again, what makes those row 8 interesting is the P6. The P6 is full. That's sort of a big picture of what's going on in the periodic table. Any questions? Because once we got that down, then understanding bonding types is pretty easy. So we have an ionic bond, and there's two types of bonding we'll look at. There is no third type. So most people are familiar with Star Wars. We had some discussion over Star Trek. I won't use Star Trek anymore in the morning class because nobody knew what I was talking about. So I will stay away from that. Green is neutral. On the ionic side, yeah, I had a blue one here. There it is. You have ionic compounds. on one side of the fence, and the other side of the fence, you're going to have covalent compounds. First up, ionic. To have an ionic compound, you need a metal and a non-metal. Your metal will be your cation. And cations, just like we did with protons, cations are red and they're positive. Anions about 99.9% of the time are nonmetals. I should have used that disclaimer up there too, because there is a polyatomic ion that's nonmetals. It is a cation. We'll get to that later. Nonmetals, most of the time, they make anions. And anions I simplify by using blue. So if we look at what we've got going on here, we've got aluminum from group 3. Okay. Aluminum is just below boron. So if I want to make an aluminum placard up there, I can. I can take this. So on your periodic table, aluminum is just below boron. Okay? The reason I put that up there is to emphasize that cation from that group is going to go +3. So when I stick my Al atom over here, it's going to be in red. And I'm going to have 3. Red ones, which means the charge balance in ionic compounds, I should stick rule 3 up there, must be charge balanced. What I'm going to do there is I'm bringing in some chlorine atom, and chlorine is right below fluorine. Okay. So this is going to bring a -1 charge. Well, if I have a -1 charge, I need 1, 2, 3 to charge balance. So my red 3 is canceled with a blue 3. And then I just put the symbols in, Cl, Cl, and Cl, and my formula is charge balanced. We'll see that in the next unit, which is writing ionic compound writing formulas, which is specific there. Any questions there? That right there is a nutshell of
ionic compounds, question?
Is metallic bonds a thing?
So if you had metals, it would be ionic. The minute you say metallic, you're referring to ionic. Because an ionic bond, by definition, has to have a metal in it. There is one exception we'll get to, that's the ammonium ion. But by, when you say metallic, you're saying ionic. Of course, unless it's an element, then it's bonded with itself. And that would be a metallic bond. So like a chunk of aluminum is held by metallic bonds. But aluminum, any kind that comes in contact with another element, it's either gonna, aluminum's gonna ionically bond. Because it forms the cation. That's its fate in life, which we'll see in chemical reactions. When we do, say, balancing a single displacement versus a double displacement, is all based on charge. And then you can get to covalent bonds, which is going to be green, because covalent compounds, you have no charges in them. Hey, you're talking no ions and no metals. And the example I have there is CO2. Carbon and oxygen are nonmetals. Notice I have no magnets up there because there's no charges. This results from sharing of all electrons. All electrons in a covalent bond are shared. You guys want to keep going? We got technically got about 5 more minutes, but this is a good place to park the bus. You want to park the bus or keep going?
Park it,
okay. Yeah, because the next thing we have to start is that's a whole new packet. And it really takes more than 5 to 10 minutes to really get this thing going. Because once we're going, I like to finish it out rather than do a start and stop on that. So that'll be for next time. How about we meet in lab at, say, 12:15? Not gonna work. Because that starts, this is where chapter 6 would start, which chapter 6 starts with the actual unit 2 handout, which I'll get to you next time.